Welcome to worship today. My name is Ashley, and I'm so glad that we can be here together and worship at Grace and experience the presence of God in a really meaningful way. Whether you're here in person or you're watching online, I know that it's going to be a great day. As you came in today, you got one of these Connect cards, and we'll talk about that in just a little bit. But if we want to go ahead and stand and sing Lord of the Dance. This morning, you got one of these Connect cards. And one way that we can stay connected is by praying for each other. So if you have any prayer requests that you would like to share, either in the newsletter, which we print out and pray over on Sundays, gets mailed out or emailed out on Mondays, you can write those down and mark that. Or if you would like just the pastor to pray over that, you can do that as well. If this is your first time submitting a Connect card, there's a box there for you to do that. Welcome to worship. If this is your first time, we're so happy that you could be here with us. When you submit it and click that box, someone from the office gets a hold of you and donates $5. We donate $5 just to celebrate that you are here today. You don't have to do a thing for that. And we call and ask which nonprofit you would like us to donate that to. And if you have any questions about faith, there's a spot for you to write that down there as well. Let's take a moment, and Tobin's going to come and play a song for us. The lyrics will be up. But I just invite you to sit and prayerfully reflect during this song.
Mm-hmm. do is follow. It's a new way for you and me. It's so easy, can't you see? Jesus Christ, our Savior, is born. Jesus Christ, our Savior, is Lord. He sent His Son as a sacrifice, so that we might walk in the light. And He shows us wrong from right, and He gives us eternal life. Jesus Christ, our Savior above. Jesus Christ, our Savior of love. I never thought there could be someone like you. Never thought there could be a love so true. Now I know just what I'm gonna do. Gonna leave this world behind and follow you. Lowly shepherds shake in fright. An angel comes to them in the night. A multitude joins from above, singing praises of God's new love. Jesus Christ, our Savior, is born. Jesus Christ, our Savior, is Lord. The shepherds go and they find the babe in the manger where He was laid. They told the story of what they saw, springing good news to one and all. Jesus Christ, our Savior, is born. Jesus Christ, our Savior, is Lord. I never thought there could be someone like you. I never thought there could be a love so true. Now I know just what I'm gonna do. Gonna leave this world behind and follow you.
Let's pray together. God, we are so grateful that we can be here together and worship you and worship Jesus, who you sent so we could follow. And there are a lot of things that we seem to carry with us that make it hard to follow sometimes, and Jesus invites us to put those down. So God, I pray that you would give us the strength to do that so that we can follow and leave this world behind. God, we lift up the prayers, the worries, concerns, sorrows, but also the great joys and celebrations that we have. We know there are things that we don't quite have words yet for, but that you know what they are. We thank you for listening and loving us so well. I just pray that as we go into the world, that you would help us love like you do. We pray this with the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever.
If this is your first time here, I just want to say welcome. I'm Pastor Chris. I'd love to meet you after the service today. I love the Christmas carols that get sung this time of year. I'd like to invite you all to stand and sing Silent Night. On Christmas Eve, at the very end of the service, where we light our candles representing the light of Christ, and we pass that light around the room as we sing Silent Night. Christmas Eve at 7 p.m. this year. I wonder, who are you planning to invite for Christmas Eve? Because we are a church, we've said this over and over, we are a church that exists not for ourselves, but for those who are not here yet. Who do you have in mind? Who's God put on your heart to invite Christmas Eve? We're always a church that's asking, how can we serve someone else if we say this is good for us? Who are the people that have no one to invite them Christmas Eve? I want to thank you for being part of this church, for being part of this mission that we're involved in together of serving the community. We say when we join together as a congregation, when people become members here, they commit to serve in this mission with their physical presence, prayers, their financial gifts, their physical service, their verbal witness. These are commitments that we make. Prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. And I just want to thank you for being part of this, for making a difference for others. Today is a very special day. Today we get to celebrate a baptism. We get to celebrate the baptism of Emmy. And this is especially exciting for us as a church. This is our first baptism we've gotten to do since we formed together as a congregation. So this is an exciting day. The sacrament of baptism is special. A sacrament is just a fancy word for an opportunity to experience God's love and grace. We have two sacraments that we really lift up in the United Methodist Church that we say these are special vessels of God's grace, that we experience God's grace in them through baptism and through communion. Through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's church. Not just the United Methodist Church, Christ's church, the bigger church, the church where Jesus is the head of around the world. And when we do this, we say the person is being incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation. They're given new birth by water and the Spirit. And every bit of this is a gift from God offered without price. When we baptize an adult, we're celebrating the ways that God has already filled them with God's love and God's grace and God's forgiveness and God's transforming power. When we baptize a baby or a child or an infant, when we baptize a child who's not able to really speak for themselves, what we're affirming is God's promise to work God's grace in their life, as well as the promise of the parents and of the church and the sponsors to raise the child as a child of God until they can make that choice for themselves. For both infants and adults, what we do is we promise to surround them with love and support and prayer as they continue to walk in the way that leads to life. Today, I present Emmy Lynn Hinton for baptism. Emmy and family and sponsors, you can come forward. Emmy is the daughter of Nate and Shelby Hinton. Today, her parents will be making vows. It's a little new, right? Today, her parents are gonna make vows to support her in her relationship with Jesus. Her sponsors, Rich and Julie McClure, they're going to make vows to support Emmy in her relationship with Jesus. And you, each of you, the congregation, you're going to make these vows to support her in her walk with Jesus. I'm gonna move this stand out of the way. I'll invite you, so all of you can see. You all come right on over here. Perfect, welcome. And I'm going to ask you some questions, okay? So first, the question is for the parents and the sponsors, okay? Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do. And now I'm going to ask this question. Will you nurture Emmy in Christ's holy church that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly and to lead a Christian life? If so, say, I do. Rich and Julie, I have a question for you. Will you sponsor Emmy by supporting and encouraging her in her Christian faith? And now for all of you, do all of you as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Jesus Christ? If so, say, we do. Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you in your care? If so, read the words on the screen. With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their trust in Jesus and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Let's all join together in professing the Christian faith. You're all on it. Professing the Christian faith contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord? Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I'll let you finish the rest of it. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Let's pray. Please join the words on the screen at the appropriate times. Eternal God, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and you brought forth light. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. You saw us and set us free. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of her womb. He was baptized by John in the water and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations so that all may know your love. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. Amen. Hi, Emmy. You see your grandma and grandpa?
Yeah.
Isn't that pretty special that they're there? I want to show you something. Do you see all those people out there? Do you know why they're here and why they're smiling at you? Because they love you. Some of them you know. Some of them you don't know yet. Some of them are going to be your Sunday school teachers, and your Wednesday night teachers, and youth group leaders. Some of them are going to be people who you see as you're getting snack before and after church. And you know what they're going to do? They're going to give you a high five. They're going to say, "Hi, Emmy, how are you doing?" And you know why? Because they love you and care about you. That's kind of what we're doing today, is we're celebrating that all these people love you, and you know who else? God loves you. So that's what we're going to celebrate. Mom, I'm wondering if she'd be happier if you hold her.
Probably.
All right. Sounds good. Emmy Lynn Hinton, I baptize you in the name Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'd like to invite all of our family, if you don't mind. I mean, do you mind if we put a hand on your shoulder here and pray for you? Okay, put a hand on your shoulder. We'll pray. The Holy Spirit work within you, Emmy, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, it is our joy to welcome our new sister in Christ. Let's read these words on the screen. Through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation. We are all one with Jesus Christ. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as part of the family of Christ. And so, members of the household of God, I commend Emmy to your love and to your care. Do everything in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. Please respond with the words on the screen. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant to faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, then everything, God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. We have confidence that the God of all grace is going to establish and strengthen you, Emmy, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you will live a life of grace and peace. Let's celebrate our new sister in Christ. I have this for you. Thank you. You may all have a seat. There's something so exciting about welcoming in a little one like this. I have a question for you. It's a Christmas-oriented question. Raise your hand. Have you ever done Elf on the Shelf? All right, some of you have. I was not familiar with this tradition as a kid. I'd never heard of it. One day, I was talking to some kids about what they were doing. They said, oh, this is what my elf did. What's an elf? What are you talking about? What people do is they hide elves. They have this cute little mischievous-looking elf, and they hide it somewhere in the house. They put it on a shelf. They put it somewhere in the bathroom. They put it in the kitchen. They hide it in a cabinet. You're about to get your Doritos. And instead, look, there's an elf. Okay, so they do it, and the idea is to surprise people. Where would be a surprising person that you would like to hide an elf on a shelf? What I'll do is I'll ask you to stand and turn to someone in a different row than you and answer this question for them. Where would you hide an elf on a shelf? If you're online right now, put your answer in the chat, respond to one another's answer, or even better, click one of those chairs in the Altar Live app, click one of those seats, and then click a seat next to someone else so that you can have a conversation with them. Where would you hide an elf on a shelf in the house? Somewhere to be a little funny or mischievous. It doesn't actually have to be in the house. It could be at your workplace, could be in someone's car, could be anywhere. Where would you hide it to surprise someone? I'll have you do that on the count of three. One, two, three.
You've done the elf on the shelf for many years, so it's been in our car. It's been in our car. It's been in the blender, in the kitchen, you know, inside of the coffee pot. One time came out and we have a big fireplace, so the elf on the shelf, which she got first.
Shower. That would be funny, right? Yeah, where else?
Steering wheel of the car.
Steering wheel of the car. All that. I've seen pictures of people that hit it out there driving the car. Yeah. I heard another one.
On the fan blade of your ceiling fan.
Oh! They turn it on and it starts flying around. What just hit the wall? Yeah. The whole elf on the shelf thing, if I understand it right, I'm talking as a guy who's never actually had an elf on the shelf, so what do I know? But if I understand it right, the idea is to surprise people, to do the unexpected. They didn't see it coming, and sometimes it helps you get away with something, because I didn't eat the pie, it was the elf. We're starting a series, actually, we're in the third week of a series, Expecting Christmas. Because as we enter this holiday season, we come into it expecting Christmas. But what does that mean? What is it that we're expecting when it comes to Christmas? We're expecting fa-la-las and carols and songs. We're expecting decorations. By the way, I'm so appreciative of everyone who decorates the front of their house. I know I don't do a good job of that, but I love going around with my daughter and seeing all of the great decorations. We expect some of that. We expect seeing loved ones. We expect something magical in the air. And the story of Christmas, we expect to be re-inspired by the story of Jesus' birth. And sometimes with the things we expect, all our expectations work out just fine. But sometimes some of the things we're expecting as we enter this season, and things aren't the way we were expecting, there's a loss. And that's hard too. And then when we enter the story of Christmas, it's supposed to be breaking news. It's supposed to be this really big deal. It's supposed to be this earth-shattering statement. And yet, if you've heard the Christmas story year after year after year, does it still feel like breaking news? Does it still amaze you? Because I'll tell you, in the scripture we're about to hear, when the shepherds heard the announcement, they were amazed. They were amazed, and they are moved to do something, to see it for themselves, to see if what they could find matched what they heard. And when it did, they told everyone that they could. And when they told everyone that they could, the people who they told were amazed. Let's hear this scripture from Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 17.
Nearby, shepherds were living in the fields, guarding their sheep at night. The Lord's angels stood before them. The Lord's glory shone around them, and they were terrified. The angels said, "Don't be afraid. Look, I bring good news to you. Wonderful, joyous news of all people. Your Savior is born today in David's city. He is called Christ the Lord. This is a sign for you. You will find a newborn babe wrapped snugly and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great assembly of the heavenly forces was with the angels praising God. They said, "Glory to God in heaven, and on earth, peace among those whom he favors." When the angels returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go right now to Bethlehem and see what's happened. Let's confirm what the Lord has revealed to us." They went quickly and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. When they saw this, they reported what they had been told about this child.
Thank you. So I know we've heard the same story. Many of us have heard the same story year after year after year. So to help us grasp the angel's message for us today, I tried putting it into what's online known as a Gen Z translator, to put into a fresh perspective where you type in text, and it spits out to you as a Gen Z person would say it texting. Now, I'm not convinced that that's actually how they would say it, but it was interesting. Let's see. The angel's message, I just put in the angel's message, "Don't be afraid. Look, ya boy." I don't even know what that means. "Bring Liddy news." I know what Liddy means. That's good. "Bring Liddy news to you. Wonderful, joyous news for all bros." I think bros is people. "Your Savior be born today in David's city. He be Christ the Lord. This be a sign for ya. Ya will find a newborn baby wrapped snugly and lying in a manger." I was hoping that if I read that out loud, I would look older than I am. I think it worked. But I understand most of that, so I tried an emoji translator. And the idea is, can we see this story fresh again? Don't be afraid. Look, I bring good news to you. Wonderful, joyous news for all people. Your Savior is born today in David's city. He is Christ the Lord. This is a sign for you. You will find a newborn baby wrapped snugly and lying in a manger. It's a story we've heard so many times. I started hearing it as a little kid. I remember Christmas plays that I was in. How did Christmas become so predictable? Because it is predictable. It's the same story every year. And in practice, what that means for us is here's what I see. We have a shyness about the Christmas story. At least I do. It's kind of like when I want to tell someone, and I think about telling someone about my favorite TV show. Do you know what my favorite TV show is? I bet none of you do, because I'm kind of shy about it. I don't want to tell anyone, because I'm thinking, what if they don't like the same show? What if they think it's a weird show? What if they think I'm weird for liking this show? Someone out there is wondering what show does Pastor Chris like. Has anyone else here been watching Andor this fall? Yes, we have a couple of you. I knew most of you hadn't seen it, right? Yeah, so for those of you who enjoy Star Wars, for those of you who are Force sensitive, you know that this is a prequel to the Star Wars series, it's a spinoff of the Star Wars program. But I think to myself, I don't know if I really want to talk about it to other people because they're probably not watching it. They probably don't know about it. They probably are thinking I was a Trekkie anyway. I'm not interested in what those Star Wars people are doing. And when we talk about Christmas, even when we talk about Christmas, we have code phrases. The reason for the season. The spirit of the season. The magic of the season. We don't go too far in depth into what does the season mean for us? Even if we were to say Jesus is born, but what does that mean for me? And if that's the way we talk about it to other people, how much more is that the way we talk to ourselves? I actually did a Google search. I was curious, what would come up when I typed in the reason for the Christmas season or the message of Christmas? And I typed in the message of Christmas and see what popped up. Did you know the first two answers had nothing to do with Jesus? Isn't that interesting? And the ones that did have something to do with Jesus was, here's what Christians have in their belief system about Jesus. But it's a side note to the meaning of Christmas in our culture today. Isn't that interesting? But is it any different for people of faith? If we look at our experience, most of this Christmas season, we're hurried. We're trying to get it all done. We're trying to get it all prepared. We're stressed that we don't have enough time, enough money, enough of the budget for that thing that we think we need to get for that person. And while we're getting that thing for that person, we see the thing that we really need to get for ourselves, but we can't afford that either. And then there's worry that not only do we not have enough, there's a worry that we aren't enough. This gets a little personal here, but many of us know what I'm talking about here, that worry of not only can I not provide this, or I don't have my people getting together, but what if I was a better person, if I was a greater person, if I had lived differently, maybe I would be enough, that things would be different. And did you know Christmas season is the time when people feel the most isolated, the most lonely? Especially when the hustle and bussing and hurry and scurry stops. And people think to themselves, will I ever be wanted? What does that mean we believe that God has done at Christmas? Someone might look at the way Christmas season is celebrated and think that people of faith believe God did something really ordinary at Christmas, or something predictable, or something that at least has no bearing on their worry and their stress and their isolation. It would send the message, maybe we believe. I ask you, just check yourself. Do you not believe any of these? That God doesn't really care about my needs. There is some baby born long ago in the city of Bethlehem. But God isn't present with what I'm going through. God doesn't see little people like us. Or God is too heavenly minded to be of any earthly good. But today we have the opportunity to let this story change our minds. Because we really don't believe those lies about God and those lies about Christmas, even if sometimes our actions and our posture say that we do. What God did that night in and near Bethlehem, God came near. And who did God came near to? Every one of us. We have this idea that God is on this ethereal heavenly plane and we're on this earthly plane and never the two may meet. But at Christmas, God says, just watch. And God is born in a baby to grow up in human life. And the message given to the shepherds is your savior, your rescuer is born. And can you believe it? In the text we just read, the announcement came to who first? The shepherds of all people. The outsiders. The lowly. The forgotten. And in that moment that you feel forgotten by people, by family, by friends, by God, the message of Christmas is God went to you first. God arranged it so that the announcements would come to the shepherds, and not that it would come to them at church. The shepherds, they were busy out in the field. They hardly were able to come to church. They weren't the kind of people you'd see in worship on Sunday morning. God arranged so that the message would come to them while they were at work. And it was personal. The angel says, I bring good news to you. For all people, but to you. Your Savior is born. And here's the sign for you. Well, the shepherds, they left right away. They wanted to see this news for themselves. And they saw for themselves what was said to them by the angels. They saw it. What does this tell you about God? That God came. That God stepped foot there. That God told them. That God's present. God is not far away, off in heaven somewhere. Maybe you're looking through a telescope at Earth. No, God is present. Can you imagine the angels' experience when they were watching their sheep, minding their sheep, and they hear this message from the angel and they're terrified. And they get this message, hey, don't be afraid. There's good news and it's for you. It's for all people, but it's for you. And I'm bringing this message to you. And then the whole army of heaven shows up in the sky all at once, and they realize the heavenly realm is not that far away from the earthly realm. God is right here with us. God sees us at our lowest point, and he cares about our needs. There's a song written by Elisa Crow. It's called Come All You Unfaithful. And the words of it go something like this. Come, all you unfaithful. Come, weak and unstable. Come, know you are not alone. Come, barren and waiting once. Weary of praying, come. See what your God has done. And Lisa wrote this, the first draft of this song, one Christmas, the first Sunday of Advent. She had been going through some hard things. And she said to her church, I can't stand up and sing this Sunday. I'll sit in the congregation, but I can't sing. I can't pretend to be happy. I can't sing happy Christmas carols. And it was their first Sunday. They start out with this song, "O come all joyful and try. Come all you faithful, joyful and triumphant." She says, "I'm not sure how faithful I am, because right now I'm not sure if God's really there for me. I sure don't feel triumphant because everything's going wrong. And is Christmas really for me?" And she gets home after church, and she just needs to process what she's thinking and experiencing. At that song, she just had to sit down. She couldn't even pretend to sing. And she came home, and she started writing these lyrics. "O come, all you unfaithful, weak and unstable, you are not alone. Christ is born, Christ is born, Christ is born for you. Come bitter and broken, come with fears unspoken. Taste of his perfect love. Come guilty and hiding ones, there is no need to run. See what your God has done. Because the angel came to the shepherds and says, don't be afraid. I bring good news to you where you're at with what you're going through and the situation that you didn't expect to be in. What does that tell you about who you are? It means you are loved by God. And you are not as alone as you might have once believed. And like this, at Christmas, even in the midst of hurt and brokenness and emptiness, whatever it is that you are going through, and everyone's going through something, there's still a place for joy, a place for peace, a place to know your love. I'd like to invite our worship team to come forward and lead us in this song, "O Come, All You Unfaithful." Please stand.
Peace.
much your God has done. Christ is born. Christ is born. Christ is born for you. Christ is born. Christ is born. Christ is born for you.
You may be seated. We come to Jesus to remember who we are and who we are. At Christmas, remember Christ was born for us. One way we do this is to celebrate communion together. Let's prepare our hearts to receive this gift by praying our prayer of confession. The words are on the screen. Almighty God, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We have not loved ourselves as you love us. Forgive us and set us free to follow you, so that we may grow, serve, and love as Jesus loves. Amen. Hear the good news. Jesus died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Communion is for you. It is for you. If you desire to love Jesus, to turn away from the brokenness that's in your life, and you want God to heal the brokenness in the relationships around you. If you're watching live, please join this communion celebration. Get your bread and juice ready. If you don't have bread and juice available, whatever you do have is acceptable to God, because you are acceptable to God. For those here in person, you'll be invited to come forward to receive bread and juice. All the elements today are gluten-free. This is how Jesus celebrated the first communion with his followers. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread and he broke the bread, gave thanks to his Father, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Eat of this, all of you. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to his Father and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for me for the forgiveness of sins." Let's pray together as our worship hosts come forward. Heavenly Father, we are grateful. You created us to love and to be loved. When we turned away and our love failed, your love always remained steadfast. You never gave up on us. And your Son, Jesus Christ, you revealed yourself to us and you taught us how to love. By his suffering, death, and resurrection, you delivered us from slavery to sin and death. In remembrance of everything that Jesus did for us, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. So pour out your Holy Spirit on us. Now these gifts of bread and cup, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Amen. Today, my prayer for you is that you experience the gift of the presence of Jesus with joy. God has come near. The bread which we receive is a sharing in the body of Christ, and the blood which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Receive the invitation with confidence that the God who always was, always is, and always will be, loves you, has come near, and loves you with an everlasting love. If you're online worshiping, you may take and eat now. This is the body and blood of Christ given for you. If you're in the room, I'll tell you, the meal is for you. It's prepared for you. It's a gift from Jesus. You don't have to be a United Methodist to receive it. You don't have to have ever come into a church before today to receive it. It is for you. You are welcome. When you're ready, come.
Thank you.
Jesus came as our rescuer. You walked our path to set us free from our pain, our sin, our compulsions, our ice. You came to reveal your love for us. 2,000 years later, there are still so many people who don't know your love. Many have been misled to believe that you came to condemn and control and destroy. And others have come to the conclusion that you never came at all. Or if you did, your coming was of no consequence. Make us open to use our words and our actions to show our friends, relatives, acquaintances, neighbors, and coworkers that you can set people free. We ask that you do this by the power of your Holy Spirit, which you sent for us. Amen. The shepherds, they couldn't keep the news to themselves. And they told the news. They told the good news. And the news was given to them by the angels. And everyone who heard it was amazed. Amazed that God came near. Amazed that the rescuer had come. And amazed that God chose to spread his message through the shepherds of all people. Together, let's sing the song in a loud voice, O come, Emmanuel, because we trust Jesus to come and be with us. Let's stand and sing. Supper right here at 5:15, followed by a Christmas journey walk. And I don't know about you, but I kind of like pancakes. I'm guessing I'm not the only one here. And the people who make pancakes here, they do really good at making pancakes. But even better, the story of Jesus, the story of Christ's birth, right afterwards. It was created a Christmas journey for the children to know the Christmas story. But the funny thing is the adults who've gone through it have said, this is beautiful. They did it for the first time last year, and then they're going to do it again this year. It'll be at 5:15 this Wednesday night. If you know of any families that you think, you know, I think their kids would really enjoy going through seeing the Christmas story, I think that'd be worthwhile to them. They'd love it. Invite them to come and join it. I think last year, about a third of the people that came weren't regularly part of our Wednesday night ministry. That's my recollection anyway. The week from this Sunday, so next Sunday, the 11th, it's going to be the kids program during worship. And then the following week will be a cantata during worship that Sunday. And then Christmas Eve, 7 p.m. Receive this blessing and benediction. Oh, one thing that I forgot several times today. This is important. There's cake back there. Did anyone else see that? To celebrate Emmy's baptism. So please have a slice. It looks remarkable. So anyway, go back, enjoy the cake, celebrate, and enjoy the conversation with one another today. Receive this blessing. God came near to you. To you. May you go forth in peace and joy and wholeness. And may your light shine Christ's light. Amen.